The following podcast is a presentation of This Is Infamous. Listener discretion is advised.
Welcome to the CineFiles podcast, Mr. Bond. Welcome. Today is episode 10. We made it to 10, folks. 10 podcast episodes of CineFiles podcast. This is Eric Cohen, co-producer and co-host of the CineFiles. We also have Andre Joseph, fellow co-host of the CineFiles, and Jeff Galishaw, co-host of the CineFiles, primary host and producer of Unfinished Business. Say hello, gentlemen.
Hello.
Land.
We made it to 10 episodes.
Hooray!
We should celebrate or something. I'm celebrating by drinking iced coffee while we're recording this. That's crazy.
Well, ironic, because I'm having hot coffee right now.
I'm just having ice water.
Andre and I are matter and antimatter. If we were in the same room, we'd explode.
Hail Hydra.
Anywho, so let's move things right along, because there's a lot to talk about. We had a lot of trailers released since we last recorded this podcast. A lot of news updates, specifically with regard to the discussion we had last time with the Wonder Woman movie.
Oh, yes.
Right? It's like immediately the day after they chose the new director that they replaced. We'll get into that. And ironically, it was a name that we didn't bring up in our discussion. So there you go. And I don't know why we didn't bring her up, because it seemed like an obvious choice. But anywho, we'll get to that down a little bit later. But let's start off with the films we've recently seen, as we usually do. Andre, anything you've seen since we last recorded?
Yes, I finally saw Tim Burton's latest movie, Big Eyes.
Yes, I saw that as well. What'd you think?
I was pleasantly surprised how good it was. I mean, it was a really good departure from, you know, the last couple of Johnny Depp outings that have been a little too commercial for everybody's taste. And here, it's kind of like, I don't know. I don't want to say like he goes back to Ed Wood territory here, but it's a really, like, I never knew anything about Margaret Keane and her husband, but I just found the whole story to be very, ironically enough to say, just with, you know, the whole forgery aspect of the story, and the performances were excellent. Christoph Waltz was great as always, and Amy Adams really knocked that out of the park. It was a very nice story. It was well written, and I definitely recommend it as one of Burton's best.
I liked it. I wouldn't say I loved it, but I liked it. I wouldn't say it's a memorable film to me. Yeah, I did see it in the theaters when it first came out. I think the story is very, very interesting. I think it's interesting that they cast Christoph Waltz in that role, considering that the actual character is born and bred American. But I thought it was fine. I thought it's definitely one of Tim Burton's better, more coherent films in a while.
Christoph Waltz, I was a little critical of him with the Spectre trailer recently, because I feel like now he's starting to kind of parody himself in some of his performances after working with Tarantino. But still, I found myself entertained by him, especially at the end when he's testifying in court and he decides not to go with the lawyer. Well, the lawyer abandons him, and then he ends up having to, like, basically put himself on trial. I found to be very hilarious and amusing all at once.
Well, see, that's the problem I had with the film, was Christopher Waltz's performance, because it felt like he was a circus performer throughout. I never believed him. I never felt he had credibility. And I just was like, yo, this takes me totally out of the realm of any seriousness of this film.
Okay, so Jeff has seen the film as well. Okay, mm-hmm. Cool. So all three of us have seen it. I'm in that strange place where I agree with both of you, you know, in a weird kind of way. Like I said, this is my take on Big Eyes. I liked it enough. I think it's Tim Burton's most coherent film in a very long time.
Yes.
Most complete feeling film. But I don't think it's a particularly memorable film.
I can see that.
You know, by the end of the year, this will not be on my radar. I'm trying to remember films I thought were the best films of the year. Let's just put it that way. I thought Christoph Waltz was fine in it. I thought he was exactly what that character needed to be. Now, apparently there is controversy, although I don't know the full story, that this is just one side of the story. Apparently there's some compelling facts out there that maybe he wasn't quite the con artist he's been made out to be. But it still makes for an interesting story. I thought Amy Adams was decent in it. Thought she was good in it.
Yeah, I liked her more than usual in this film.
Mm. Yeah, it had an interesting sort of cast of cameos and supporting parts.
Terrence Stamp.
Yes, Terrence Stamp was great in it, actually. Terrence Stamp plays this sort of this art snob critic who absolutely hates Christoph Waltz's character. It's one of those films that I'd recommend if it's on cable. Or available on Netflix so you can stream it, you know, that kind of thing. But anything else, Andre, besides Big Eyes?
That's basically it, just mostly television.
Jeff.
Yes.
What have you seen recently?
Well, I saw Lost River and put my opinion of that on cinefilestv.blogspot.com.
Yes, you did.
Other than that, I finally saw A Girl Walks Home Alone at Night.
What did you think?
I loved it. I mean, the thing that seems strange to me is that it seems to be the reverse online, whereas when it comes to Lost River, you have all these people saying that it's a masterpiece, except for critics. And whereas when A Girl Walks Home Alone at Night, I thought, you know, more movie fans would be behind it. But they're like, oh, it's pretentious. Oh, it's style over substance. And I'm like, I really got into this film a lot more than I got into Lost River.
Well, you remember my thoughts on the film two or three podcasts ago. I absolutely adored A Girl Walks Home Alone at Night. I thought it was fantastic.
I really enjoyed it. I mean, I know one person's argument was that, oh, well, it has no intention or interest in being a horror film. And I'm like, that's because it's not a horror film.
Right.
It's like, I liked it for what it was. I thought it was very offbeat. It kind of reminded me, strangely, of a Jim Jarmusch film.
It had a Jim Jarmusch vibe to it, definitely. It had an almost, it's interesting, I hate to like compare one director to another, but it's like a Quentin Tarantino with a female voice, a female perspective, right?
Yeah, it's very dry, I will say that.
But it's very well informed. You know, you could tell that the filmmaker behind this is pulling out of a, you know, her inspirations from a lot of different pop sources.
And I absolutely love the soundtrack. And
great soundtrack. I love the idea how this person, this vampire may have came to be during the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
Considering all the music she was into and all that stuff. I thought that was kind of cool. I liked it a lot. I already said so much on it during the one podcast. I'm not going to repeat myself. But I'm very glad that you enjoyed it as much as I did, apparently.
I thought, you know, it was one of the better films I've seen recently. I've been getting a good batting average there. And
anything else besides that on Lost River? Now, what was the what were the issues with Lost River?
For me or that?
For you, personally.
For me, I felt it was the thing everybody was complaining about, A Girl Walks Home. I felt it was a lot of style over substance. I felt the story was very nil. You know, and loosely connected. I mean, it set a tone, it set a mood, but once you got there, it was like, okay, now what? There's nothing really to register that tone and mood.
It was pretty much his style over substance. He was just doing all this stuff because he thought it'd be cool, but was it like pretentious?
I feel like his heart was in the right mm-hmm. place, but I didn't feel like he had a strong enough message in which to stand behind. Whereas even though, Only God Forgives is like a basket case of a film, mm-hmm. at least I felt there's somewhat strong narrative and reason for things and visuals that happen. Whereas here I felt like, oh, you know, the visuals are good, and sometimes they're there for a reason, But other times I felt like the visuals are just here, you know, because like you said, it would look cool.
Right.
And, right. You know, I'm not saying Ryan Gosling's a bad filmmaker. I just think maybe next time he should work with a co-writer to get his ideas more expressed. And then the visuals will come, so to speak.
Got it.
So.
Okay. And that's it. So you saw Lost River and you saw A Girl Walks Home Alone at Night. Anything else?
I saw Ex Machina.
Oh, cool. What'd you think?
I liked it. It wasn't as surprising to me as it might be for some audience members. Only because, maybe because I've just seen too many films. So I figure, oh, this is probably going to happen next. This is probably going to happen next. And to me, you know, while it offered some surprises, I still thought it was a very good film. And I implore anybody who can see it to go see it in theaters.
Yeah, I really, really want to see it. We get a lot of like sort of like sci-fi fantasy. Usually it's action oriented or space opera oriented, but rarely do we get like a hard sci-fi film.
And this one, I have to say, is the first time I really, really appreciated Oscar Isaac's performance in a film.
Oh, really? So you didn't like him in the Coen Brothers movie?
I just felt in the Coen Brothers movies, I felt like he went along with what was thrown at him in the film. Like he seemed a natural part of the film. He didn't really, to me, stand out. And
okay.
If that makes any sense.
He was excellent in that film, actually. I thought he was very, very good.
Well, see, to me, again, he just seemed like, you know, I guess for a new actor, it's noteworthy, but it seemed like he went into the mold of the Coen Brothers kind of company of actors.
Mm-hmm.
He just seemed a natural at it.
Okay.
So sometimes, I guess that, you know, when you're watching a film, you know, you think the performance, oh, he didn't do much, but that's because the whole thing is he just pretty much went like a chameleon, went with the background.
Okay.
So, I mean, and to me, he was a lot more noteworthy here than, let's say, A More Violent Year.
Got it. Oscar Isaac's fan, Andre?
You know, he's young. He's got potential. I think he's going to be a big deal in Star Wars because I'm assuming he's going to kind of take on the Han Solo type role going into the rest of the franchise. So, you know, I think he's got potential to go forward and to really become a big deal.
Do we know that for a fact, that he's going to be that kind of character?
They're saying the description from the, we'll get into the news later about Star Wars, but they're saying from the description that his character is supposed to be like a hotshot pilot and supposed to be like the best in the galaxy. And that clearly sounds like a Han Solo type.
All right. Okay. Is that all the films you guys have seen recently?
Oh, I also want to add, and I forgot to mention this, that I finally saw the Atari documentary Game Over.
Oh yeah. What'd you think? Jeff and I discussed this last week.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this was in the past week. I liked it, but I felt like most of the information was something I've already heard in other documentaries. I think the big deal was just to see the opening of the dump to prove that the myth of the buried Atari cartridges was for real.
Yeah, I didn't know all that stuff because I'm not as well versed with that community, you know, gaming culture as other people might be. I thought Zach Penn, to me, can be a bit of a hack. And I felt that this was, like, the best thing he's been involved in. You know, whatever he did with this film, it worked. And so I personally enjoyed Game Over a great deal. Which, actually, that segues into something, you know, my turn to bring up the films I've seen. Very funny story. One of the contributors to ThisIsInfamous.com, Scott Mandanko, who's otherwise known as Mascot, right? He's our gaming contributor, correspondent for This Is Infamous. He texted me like 3 in the morning last week saying that he was watching Game Over, right? Based upon my talking about it. And then in turn recommended that I check out this web series called Double Fine Adventure, which focuses on... For those of you who are part of gaming culture and all that stuff, there's this entrepreneur, Tim Schafer. He's a major sort of like well-regarded person within the indie game community. He's known for Grim Fandango, which got a re-release. And he actually is behind producing this sort of web documentary that's serialized. Each episode is about 20 minutes. Following the inception of and trying to sell this new game, which isn't new anymore. It's already been released, called Broken Age, an attempt to do an adventure-style game when people aren't making adventure games anymore, right? And it's actually pretty damn good. It's pretty candid, which is very surprising. And it all happens, like, you know, it's documented in real time. So this documentary series started, like, early 2014 or something, and it's still going on to this day because they're trying to roll out the second part through this video game, Broken Age, right? And I highly recommend it. I want to thank Scott for turning me on to that. I found myself, like, binge-watching it. You can see it on YouTube for free. It is available to people who were initially back, because the whole deal behind this particular video game, it was one of the first games to be backed by Kickstarter money.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a successful Kickstarter campaign. And so as part of, you know, one of the rewards they would give back to the backers, besides, you know, the T-shirt or a poster, they gave them access to these documentary episodes before anyone else could see them. So, like, two documentaries episodes might be completed, but you can't view them yet. You have to be a part of this, you know, backer community in order to view them. So you have to wait, like, another 2 weeks or so before you can view them on YouTube. So when you see on YouTube, it's, like, maybe two episodes behind. But still, it's still well worth seeing, because there's a lot to catch up on. I highly recommend it.
Okay.
So that was my segue into that. But I've seen a lot, actually, since we last talked. There was that. There is, I revisited Chinatown.
Mm.
It still holds up. The movie is just amazing. It's amazing in the sense that it's one of the most perfectly directed, perfectly written, perfectly acted, perfectly edited movies I've ever seen. And just revisiting it, you know, like, I'll revisit, like, every 5 or 6 years, and I'm constantly surprised at how well it holds up. It's really that good. It deserves its one of the greatest films of all time status and one of the best written screenplays. Robert Towne, who wrote the screenplay, it really is that good. It really is that good. I know you guys have seen Chinatown, but I don't know how recently.
I've seen Chinatown last time, probably like maybe 2 years ago. And yeah, I mean, it's still classic. It still has one of the most shocking twists in the film. And Nicholson's great. Faye Dunaway is great. Polanski's work is...
John Huston is great in it.
Yes, yeah. Huston, oh my God. I mean, it really is an unbelievable quintessential Private Eye movie. And funny enough, I did see the sequel recently to Two Jakes. And honestly, that's nowhere near that level.
No, but you know what? I think Two Jakes is a little underrated. It is flawed. It has problems. But it's not a bad film. There's some really good things in it. I think the problem is it's so competing with what Chinatown was, the point that they're repeating things, where it takes a surprise element away from it. The one thing, though, is what I think is fascinating about Chinatown, it's not, to me, in my mind, it's not a quintessential Private Eye movie. It's an anti-film noir in a lot of ways, where you're presented with a character who could be the archetypal, you know, archetype of the film noir Private Eye. But he's really, he's not as smart as he thinks he is, and he's an asshole.
Well, yeah,
and there's a lot of similarities to Jake Giddey's, the Private Eye lead of Chinatown, and the Mike Hammer of Kiss Me Deadly, I find, in the Robert Aldrich movie version, which we discussed in our film noir, our classic film noir episode. But these are characters who don't think before they react, and they tend to, you know, bring issues onto themselves as a result of that, because Jack Nicholson's character is very, like, PR obsessed and all that stuff. It's really interesting how he's presented in that film. But yeah, so I saw Chinatown. I revisited that. I also revisited Face Off, the Nick Cage, John Travolta movie, which I have not seen since it first came out. It's a lot of fun.
It's enjoyable. I love it.
It's a lot of fun. And John Woo, you know, John Woo, I love his, like, Asian films. I think his mm-hmm. American films.
Yes.
I really, it's a fine line between being great entertainment and being Michael Bay kind of entertainment, the way he approaches stuff. And with Face Off, his approach is absolutely necessary in order to suspend your disbelief. It has to be this heightened, almost operatic, melodramatic take on what's going on there, because the actual premise itself is so ludicrous.
Of course.
It can't work any other way than the way he approaches it. And that really aids in the film, and it never outstays its welcome. It just, when it gets to be a little too over the top, it pulls itself back a little bit. Although there are little elements there that are kind of sloppy where you can tell, absolutely see the stuntmen. Where it's clearly not Nicolas Cage and it's clearly not John Travolta. But Travolta and Cage, man, you could tell they had a blast playing each other.
Of course.
Or playing each other's interpretation of their characters. It's very enjoyable to watch. Anything but a boring movie.
Yeah, people seem to shit on it now these days because they think Cage overacted, but I thought he fit perfectly for what they needed.
That's interesting. Go ahead, Jeff.
No, I was going to say, Cage overacted like John Travolta wasn't?
Yeah, John Travolta hands it up just as much as he does.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Even when John Travolta is playing the character, that the main FBI guy, his anguish and his desperation is very, very overdone, but it works for the film. It has to be that way in order to suspend your disbelief over this, completely ridiculous premise. And there's, certain things that don't make sense. Okay, so obviously, we understand that John Travolta has to not only get his face switched, but his hair cut, right? And they have to remove the fat from his gut so he can look exactly like Nick Cage, both in body, hair, and face. But what I don't understand is, with Nick Cage, what did he do? Did they add fat to his body? And where did he get the hair to look like John Travolta's hair? And then more importantly, when John Travolta reverts back to his original self, where did his hair come from? Did they that's a part that I don't understand. It's like,
you're thinking too much.
I know, but it's one of those things that I know it's a nitpick, but it's one of those things where I'm like, wait a second. That character will have to either be wearing a wig or they took the scalp off of, Nicolas Cage. I have no idea what's going on there. How is it that he could have that hair back when he clearly got it cut? But anyways, that's the only thing.
I still think at the end when, Cage as Travolta gets killed, when he gets impaled, that his voice should have started cracking and turning into Cage's voice.
They sort of do. Well, didn't they sort of do a little bit that with Nick Cage?
They did it with Nick Cage, but yeah, with Travolta.
But I understand. Yeah. Yeah, perhaps.
Maybe they were just trying to get the shot at the end of the day and let's just finish it.
No, but that was an ADR thing. They could have done that easily.
Now, as you guys know, I've been covering the Tribeca Film Festival.
Yes.
And so a lot of embargoes have been lifted off the films I have seen so far. So I can quickly run through the ones I've seen in case you guys have any questions or interest in them. I already posted my first review of a documentary called The Wolfpack, which got a lot of positive buzz out of Sundance, but not as much positive buzz coming out of the Tribeca Film Festival. And The Wolfpack is this interesting documentary. In case those of you listening to this aren't aware, it deals with a family that have been effectively imprisoned in a basically tenement apartment on the Lower East Side of Manhattan for 18 years. There's seven siblings, one girl and six brothers. And throughout the duration of their lives, they've been imprisoned in this apartment, not once allowed to leave that apartment or explore their surroundings. Now, maybe every now and then, their mercurial father would allow them to step outside, but it had to be under controlled circumstances, under his watchful eye. And so in order to while away their boredom and their time, they obsess over all these movies they watch, they transcribe them, and then they attempt to reenact the films they fall in love with by effectively sweeting everything, right? They build their own props out of boxes and cardboard and what have you. And some of the stuff is mind-blowingly detailed. It's actually kind of awesome. And it's kind of amusing at first to see them reenact films like Reservoir Dogs and The Usual Suspects and Batman Begins, and all that stuff. But the documentary is really, really flawed. There's a lot of questions that aren't answered that should have been answered. Most specifically, the involvement of the filmmaker herself, Crystal Mosell, who stumbled upon this somehow and managed to become involved in their lives. When we see this footage she shoots of them, that is the first time anybody outside of this family has stepped foot in that apartment as a visitor. And this is a family that up to this point, the whole motivation for being in prison was about severe privacy, keeping themselves shut off from the outside world. So there's no indication there of, okay, why is it suddenly you're willing to air your dirty laundry in this such a public way on film? And how are you affected by the fact that this filmmaker has now entered your life? What are the filmmakers' thought of this? Now, I understand there's wisdom in saying, trying to take a neutral tone, staying out of the frame, because that makes your, you know, documentary more objective, quote unquote. However, she's a part of the story, whether she likes it or not. And there's a lot of stuff that happens there where you're sitting here going, but how is this possible? Like, for example, they don't explain. The father has this pathological problem with working. So he's never worked the entire time they've lived there. So how are they living? There's no explanation there. At one point, like certain kids, you know, one of the kids, I'm not spoiling anything, one of the kids decides to take advantage of a moment by escaping out of the apartment on his own. And he winds up exploring his local surroundings by wearing this Michael Myers mask he created, right? Mm-hmm. And of course, he winds up getting arrested. And then social services come in and take him to Bellevue so he could be psychologically evaluated. Well, concerning the story he had to tell, why wasn't the rest of the family psychologically evaluated? No one gets into that. There's no explanation there. So there's a lot of stuff. It's a weird documentary in a sense that, you know, you have this great premise. Basically, this filmmaker stumbled upon gold, right? Mm-hmm. And yet she doesn't really take advantage to really explore what was really going on there. It's almost like she's afraid to hurt someone's feelings. But that's my take on the documentary.
Okay.
But that's, I posted that review yesterday. I'm just completing a review for a movie called JackRabbit, which is this indie sci-fi dystopian thriller kind of thing, which was really, really interesting. I can talk about that. I thought it was very good. It reminded me a lot of, did you guys see Bellflower?
Yes.
Yeah. Came out in 20. It's very similar to that in a lot of ways. It has a similar feel and look. Although Bellflower kind of like has this thing where you can't separate the fantasy from the reality, you know, but there's this similar focus on character. It's really about the characters and their dynamics and how complex they really are in terms of emotions and all that stuff. And JackRabbit has a similar focus and feel to it. It deals with a post-apocalyptic society where apparently the entire power grid, possibly around the world, we don't know, completely shut down and everything had to reset, right? And so everyone seems to live in this city, which was in reality Austin, Texas, but it was shot in such a way where it's not recognizable, where the entire city is basically run by this corporation. And everyone's under heavy surveillance. It's like a Big Brother kind of government, right? And so these two guys come together because of the death of a mutual friend to investigate this possible mystery that there exists this like outside world beyond the city that they can escape to where there's a resistance building to overthrow this corporation. Now, I'm making it sound more Logan's Run-ish than it actually is. It feels very grounded. The future they present actually seems realistic enough and fairly compelling. And the focus is definitely on characterization. So that's something that when it comes up, I recommend that.
Okay.
And I'm trying to think, did I see anything else? Well, there's a lot of stuff that the embargo's been lifted, but I'm just going to go on. And rather than waste our time, I'd rather go on to news.
I want to talk about one more movie I saw.
Oh, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, only because I went to the premiere of it. That's why. It's a film called Carla, which is about, it's about a transgender character, but it's also about transgender community and like puts us in the middle of at least one person in the transgender community struggle, you know, with their family who don't accept them, trying to, you know, find work and, you know, find ways of money and, you know, trying to save up for the surgery to essentially become a woman because it's a man who wants to be a woman.
Now, full disclosure, you're friends with the filmmaker, correct?
I'm not friends with the filmmaker. A friend of mine is a friend with the filmmaker.
Okay.
So, I saw this film at the Ziegfeld, actually. And
wow.
Yes, it was very nice. It reminded me how much, you know, how beautiful the theater is. I would say the film is very good. You know, it's a little rough around the edges, and it's very short. I was surprised at how short it was.
Okay.
It's barely over 60 minutes. But also, I wanted to also talk about it because if you want to, I guess, basically put money in it so that it can get a wider release, you can go to Kickstarter.com. Or you can go to Carla, the movie Carla with a C, and you can also, if you donate money, you can see the film on, you know, whatever you watch your movie films on, computer, laptop, phone. You can for a limited time, you can watch the movie right then and there.
Cool. You did a shout out.
Yes. And Laverne Cox from Orange is the New Black plays a supporting role in the film.
Okay. Very cool.
That was it.
All right, well, let's move on to news, because there were a lot of trailers released since we last recorded. So let's bang out the news and we'll go on to the trailers. We got Galaxy Quest, the movie, is now going to be a TV series. I love Galaxy Quest. I think it's hilarious.
So do I, but my question, is it going to be, you know, like the movie where it's, you know, actors in real outer space, or is it going to be like a Galaxy Quest type television show?
Well, all I know is that Robert Gordon, who wrote the original screenplay, is going to be the showrunner.
Okay, so then
he also was on the writing team for Breaking Bad and now Better Call Saul. So that's promising.
Okay, so I have a little more faith in the project.
Right. So that's something. I mean, Andre, did you ever see Galaxy Quest?
Yeah, I saw it years ago, and yeah, I mean, it's definitely, like, if you're a big Star Trek fan, you'd definitely be into that, and I think a TV show prospect could work if it's done the right way.
Yeah, if it has the right team in place, the right actors, it could be hilarious.
Just don't bring back Tim Allen.
Well, he's got another show, so I don't
I was going to say, that's, like, the best movie Tim Allen has been in, is Galaxy Quest.
Pretty much.
Claws.
You know,
the first one, not the sequels.
Yeah. I like none of them.
Not for me, sorry. And here we come up with more Beauty and the Beast news, because we love the subject. Ewan McGregor is going to play Lumiere, the candlestick, that was originated by Jerry Orbach in the cartoon.
I can see it.
You can go from Jerry Orbach to Ewan McGregor.
Keep in mind that this
is a character that sings "Be Our Guest." That's his song.
Yeah, Ewan McGregor could sing.
I'm not saying he can't. It's just I don't know. It's just weird to me. It's interesting. I'm sure Ewan McGregor will bring an interesting interpretation. It just Jerry Orbach, Ewan McGregor. It'd be interesting to decide to do a musical version of Trainspotting, and Jerry Orbach played his part in the movie.
I'd be like, obviously the weight loss didn't work with the heroin.
Anyway, so that's pretty much it for news, because the rest, man, we had so many trailers come out. Mostly it's just like the third trailers to a series of trailers have been like we've got like another Jurassic World trailer. We got another Tomorrowland trailer. We got the second Fantastic Four trailer. We got... I forgot. Two pieces of news that aren't trailer-related, okay? The Preacher TV series, right? I was a huge fan of Preacher, the comic book. Huge fan. Dominic Cooper's been cast in the role of, the lead.
I have to see his interpretation of the character.
Dominic Cooper,
not my first pick.
he sometimes he's good, and sometimes I'm like, meh, you know, with him. You know, for those of you who don't know who he is, he plays the young, not Tony Stark.
Howard Stark.
Howard Stark, you know, both in both like Captain America and in Agent Carter series. He's a British actor. I try to watch this miniseries he started in where he basically plays Ian Fleming, and it's terrible. It's awful, and I don't know why they thought, oh, Dominic Cooper would make a great Ian Fleming. Looks nothing like him. It's just terrible. He's not very good in that. But there are things that he's been good in. There are things where I'm just like, God, wow, he's not a good actor. So I don't know. I'm kind of on the fence on this. Oh, and Blade Runner 2, Ryan Gosling is rumored to be the lead for Blade Runner 2. So that's something that came up. So going back, any thoughts on that?
I guess me with Blade Runner 2, it's just a case of we'll see. I offer no opinion on anything that happens till it's actually done and we start seeing things from the film.
Yeah, same here. I mean, I like the director, but, you know, it depends on the characters that they use and how old Harrison Ford's going to look.
If they're going to put him in it, very old.
Near death. Yeah. Well, I should clarify, folks, that the role that Dominic Cooper has been cast in is Jesse Custer. He is the preacher of Preacher.
I would have thought maybe Rufus Sewell.
Rufus Sewell's too old. Yeah, Rufus Sewell, isn't he like in his 50s now? I mean, Jesse Custer.
I don't think he's that old.
Yeah, he is.
Oh, man. I thought he was at least.
Well, think about it. When he did Dark City, which came out when?
97.
Right, 97.
Yeah, I was about to say 90s.
And he was probably at his earliest, maybe in his late 20s.
Okay.
Early 30s, right?
Mm-hmm.
So where'd that put him now?
No.
Right? And Jesse Custer's meant to be a young guy.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. But anyways, so now getting back to trailer. So, I mean, Jurassic World, the trailer. I see it. I'm like, I don't care.
I'm not excited about anything Jurassic since the second one.
Yeah, it just doesn't do anything for me. Andre, what do you think about Jurassic World?
I was excited when I first saw the initial teaser trailer, but now I see this, and it seems very generic to me. And even Chris Pratt, who I like, it seems like they're just trying to train him to be like the next Indiana Jones in this movie, because there's nothing really interesting other than that he's just this machismo guy in the park who can control raptors.
Right, that he's wisecracking, but he understands the dinosaurs in a way the scientists and corporate shills don't. That's a message I'm getting from that.
He's the raptor whisperer?
Something like that, yeah. Mm-hmm. Apparently there's a little bit of controversy where before they released this particular trailer, they showed a clip, which is that scene where Chris Pratt is confronting, what's her name?
Bryce Dallas Howard,
you know, and Joss Whedon went on Twitter, not really saying, well, gee, what a misogynistic feeling scene, but I think we've moved beyond this kind of like repartee between male and female characters.
But I'm like, it's a Jurassic Park sequel.
Yeah. It's like, I don't think it warrants that much attention, to be honest.
Exactly.
You know, it's not like we're dealing with a Gamergate, you know, funded movie here, you know, where, you know, you're dealing with some, like, assholes who truly have, you know, issues when it comes to regarding women and stuff like that. But
nobody would complain if it was Jeff Goldblum doing that.
Say again?
Nobody would complain if it was Jeff Goldblum in that scene.
Maybe not, but then they would be based on some sort of eccentricity characteristic on his part or something like that. So anyways, Tomorrowland, the new trailer, it's to me, it was just an extension of the last trailer, which was an extension of the trailer before that. I don't know. None of these are grabbing me so far.
Well, I want to see it. I like the idea only from reading what the supposed story is, but I will admit, yeah, the trailers, it doesn't really make it seem like anything special.
Yeah, I'm waiting for reviews on this one. I like Brett Bird as a director, but I'm not sold on it yet completely.
Star Wars trailer.
What's the start first?
I liked it up until Han Solo.
You see, I liked it when Han Solo. I liked the trailer. It got me interested.
I mean, well, I was interested either way, but it looks promising more with, you know, you seeing more footage this time. But I don't know, something about me and Harrison Ford.
See, I liked what they did with that. I thought it was just, you know, you saw enough of the older Luke Skywalker, and you saw what you need to see with Han Solo and Chewbacca, you know? And I thought the way they presented the world as it's going to be presented in this movie was pretty smart. You saw exactly what you needed to see, and that was it. You heard exactly what you needed to hear.
Yeah, especially the Darth Vader mask. I guess that's like all old and dusty and melted. And that really, I really enjoyed that image. Mm.
From a marketing standpoint, I thought it was a very well done trailer.
Yeah, I mean, one thing I will say that I like is the fact that we are going back to, there's still CG, but it doesn't look as flat as it did in the prequels. Like, we're going back to real sets, real miniatures, and real creatures, and, you know, that's something that was totally missing from those prequels. That being said, I'm still, like, I guess for me as a diehard fan of Star Wars, I mean, I'm a little scared of, obviously, the fate of some of the original characters, which I'm not going to get into, but I feel like that's coming in this one. And the guy playing the stormtrooper, Finn, something about his reactions that's really getting on my nerves. Like, it's just like his face, it's always overreacting when he's running from explosions and being shocked by
violence. Is this the kid from Attack the Block?
Yeah, John Boyega.
Yeah, I didn't mind him.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, I think he's going to be good. It's just his reactions are just a little too animated for me. But I think
it comes down to context. Like, what is he running from? Why is he running?
Maybe he just has a big jaw. That's what it is.
Maybe he's just a scared kid not used to all of this.
Maybe he's devoured a lot of sugar.
I also think, too, that at this point, you know, if you're not going to reveal a whole lot about the film for the sake of preventing spoilers, then just leave it to this one trailer and don't put out anything else, because it's going to make money no matter what.
Yeah. Unfortunately, and this is going to tie into the next trailer we're going to talk about, right? The fanboys, the fan base, whatever you want to call it, are going to demand this. And it's that tricky thing where you want to appease a fan base, you know, but at the same time, you want to do what's right for pushing the marketing on this particular film or franchise piece or whatever you want to call it. And I personally think that the way they've approached this is smart, especially when you have someone like J.J. Abrams at the helm, who is notorious for his mystery box bullshit. when we finally see the product or the finished film, you're like, what was the use of all this mystery box bullshit? This is what you're hiding from us? What's the big freaking deal? And he does this all the fucking time, and he's not doing it with this. You know, it's the way they're approaching this, I think, is just right. Just right. Hopefully they can maintain that momentum.
Yeah, I just, like, it's like with the Avengers trailers right now, where I feel like they're just going on overload with the previews and the amount of footage that's already leaked.
Exactly. I'm like, I can't, now I'm like...
I don't want to see anymore.
I feel like we get a different Age of Ultron trailer every single other day now.
Right.
It's like, how much, have we seen the whole movie at this point? If you piece it all together, we probably have, but there you go.
There's like 15 almost minutes already out there.
Yeah, it gets a little too much. Should we move on to Batman versus Superman? Dawn of Justice?
If we must.
they finally released a teaser. Visually, of course it looks visually impressive. Zack Snyder is a visually impressive filmmaker. You know, he never fails to impress visually. I kind of like come across like I'm a Zack Snyder hater. I'm not really. I think he has talent, but I view Zack Snyder similar to someone like I view Tim Burton. I view them both as I always viewed Tim Burton as a really good graphic designer, and that's the way I view Zack Snyder, but not a very good storyteller, and somehow not able to comprehend the complexities and nuances of how human beings actually work and behave. I see him trying to do what he considers to be smart, intelligent, complex things, end of air quotes. But instead, they come across as somewhat, I don't know, like immature takes on what complexity should be. You know, he confuses overcomplication with being complex and stuff like that, and it just falls sort of. It comes across. His stuff comes across as kind of dopey to me, and kind of shallow and vapid. Even though you see there's a sincere attempt to do something more than just do a tentpole film on his part. So that's the thing. That's the kind of view I have on Zack Snyder. although ironically, with Man of Steel, he wasn't the problem I had with the film. The problem I had with the film was Goyer, David Goyer, in the screenplay. But Man of Steel, I mean, Batman versus Superman, Batman v Superman, Dawn of Justice. Mm-hmm. Looking at this teaser, I see something that's visually impressive, although it doesn't seem to fit into the world that was established in Man of Steel. It looks more like, from what I see, it actually looks more like Joel Schumacher era Batman. And there's a lot of dour, voiceover, which we've heard before. You know, in the Nolan Batman flicks, the dark versus the light, this kind of stuff. You know, where good men become cruel. You know, is this the hero that we need? You know, or the hero that we deserve? You know, all that stuff. And finally, we get to see the Batsuit, right?
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people are going like, oh, wow, this Batsuit looks awesome. Finally, we're getting the Batsuit from the comics. And this is where I get so frustrated with people who are fans of comics or source materials. It's like, you know, who cares if it looks just like the comic? How about we have something that's a Batsuit that is believably functional, believably flexible?
Like Daredevil in the Daredevil series.
Yes. Something like that, where, they kind of did that with the Nolan Batman flicks. You know, it was recognizably Batman, but you believed that this was a fully functional suit to have flexibility and he could get around in it, you know? And this, I see this, the snippets you see, yes, it looks impressively bulky, but that's the thing. It looks impressively bulky. It almost looks like foam rubber to me.
And why does he need lights for eyes?
Well, that's his armor. Okay. That's his armor when he's fighting Superman. You could tell that was directly inspired from Dark Knight Rises, the Frank Miller, right? Mm-hmm. Or Dark Knight Returns comic, where there's a scene where he confronts Superman near the end, and he's wearing almost the exact same armor. That's the way he tries to beat Superman. But you don't see any kind of flexibility. He's like, everything is just poses. Even when Ben Affleck's out of the costume, he's not moving, right? So I don't know. Unless they roll out an additional trailer where they can show Batman in action, because this is the thing, you know, this is called good marketing sense. It's not about revealing too much or teasing people. It's about smart PR. What has been the chief complaint when it comes to the Batsuit in almost every film that's come out in Batman? It looks kind of clunky. It looks like the actor can't really move around in it. Could they please come up with a suit where it looks flexible, et cetera, et cetera? Well, this is like, what, the millionth iteration of Batman. The first thing you should be showing people right out of the gate is look at how this Batsuit's different from all the others and look at it move, you know? I'm not saying show a fight scene. Just show him kneeling or crouching in a classic Batman crouch, you know, or running or something. But not standing there, partially hidden by shadows, possibly in a suspicious way to hide defects in a costume design or something like that, where it grows suspicion on those who are already hating on this movie.
Well, I think that they've already kind of botched the release of the trailer, even down to the fact that it got pirated before they officially released it a couple days before its official release date. And our Billy Donnelly at This Is Infamous has reported that there was a extended trailer that played only for IMAX where the end shot is of Batman and Superman charging at each other and it cuts to black. So there's a little bit of movement of the suit, but nothing that's visible on screen except for like a GIF file that's on Twitter right now.
Right, and I saw that GIF file, and if that, yes, it's very quick, folks. It's not the best way to judge how effective that might be, but it looked cool. You know, I have to say, based on that GIF file, I was like, okay, I see what the movement, like how they're going to approach Batman's movement in this, and that's it. That looks kind of cool, I have to admit. But it's hard to tell all the way, right?
Well, this trailer, I'll see the movie either way, but it left me very underwhelmed. Mm.
You know, it's granted, it's a teaser, and the people that are trying to, like, excuse this are people saying it's just a teaser. We don't know the whole thing yet. You can't judge it just by, I'm like, but you know what? If the whole point of a film is to tease you to make you want more, to make you want to see more. And that's not what this film, this teaser does to me anyway. I can't speak for the rest of the, like, the movie going people out there that are, like, gung-ho for this movie. But that it didn't succeed in that for me. All it did was just raise suspicions in my mind. That's all it did. I was like, they're doing all this because they want to hide the fact that the suit is kind of awkward.
Okay.
Yeah, doesn't anybody remember Freddy versus Jason? Like, the hype around that and how that turned out?
Awesome.
Yeah. And I don't know if this is the same thing, though. I think that... I could be wrong about this, but I think the anticipation... Because we've been promised a Batman versus Superman for such a long freaking time. You know? For such a long time. There was going to be a Batman versus Superman.
Yeah,
like there was going to be a Justice... Yeah, right. Wolfgang Peterson. There was going to be a Justice League movie called World's Finest. Remember that?
George Miller. Yeah.
You know, all that stuff. And this stuff would not come to be if it weren't for the success of the established world building that Marvel committed to. This is like, oh, now we got to suddenly do the same thing. Let's see how Man of Steel works out. And if it's successful, then we're going to do our own world building. And thus, yes, now we're going to do a Batman versus Superman. Now we're going to do a Justice League movie. So, you know, I don't know. I feel kind of uneasy about this. And it's not like I want this to fail. I don't. I don't know. I did the teaser. There was nothing in that teaser where I thought, damn, that's grabbed me. I can't wait to see the next trailer. You know?
I agree.
Mm. What about the Fantastic Four trailer where we finally got our look at Doctor Doom?
You know, everybody's saying that it already looks a lot better than the movies from 05 and 07. And yeah, it definitely looks like they're taking the material pretty seriously. But I'm not quite sold with it yet. There's just something about it. And I guess it's because it's a Fox property that I'm just like, you know, I don't know if I really want to rush out and see this after Star Wars and after that Superman trailer. I'm not hyped up for it.
Yeah, I don't see. That's an interesting comment that you made, Andre, because I'm not. I still, from the trailers, I can't tell whether this is going to be any better or worse than the Tim Story movies, to be honest.
It just looks like a Cronenberg movie, but done with a huge Hollywood budget and a director that doesn't have his talent.
It's like they're going back to this trend that everything has to be dark and somewhat gloomy, you know, and ponderous, you know, that kind of thing. Because say what you will about the Tim Story films, they were by no means perfect, but they did somewhat capture the spirit of the comics in that they were fun. The Fantastic Four is supposed to be fun in concept, you know. Whereas what I'm seeing here is this attempt to cash in on this idea that it has to be darker, you know, and has to be grounded in some sort of reality. Although I don't know why you're trying to struggle to find a reality in a world where a guy has become the thing. Another guy can, you know, is elastic, you know, a woman turns invisible and a guy turns into a human torch, you know, just embrace the fantasy and the fun. There's nothing wrong with that. And I don't see anything in this film where I'm like, you know, I'm like, I can't tell whether it doesn't. It's another thing that doesn't excite me. I'm not seeing anything in there where I'm thinking, oh, that looks like an interesting approach to this material. I'm intrigued. There's nothing there that shouts out to me in that way at all.
Yeah, and then on top of that, like, I mean, not to continue to get into the issue of a black guy like Michael B. Jordan playing the Human Torch, but now I'm hearing, you know, he's getting a little fed up with everybody saying, why do you have... You know, you're playing this character, you also have a white sister. Like, that's overshadowing this movie.
Well, they were. I haven't heard those complaints in a while. They were complaining about that when they initially announced the casting. And I think it's pretty evident. Someone's adopted. That's fine. You know, someone is adopted. The actor who was in House of Games, he plays her father.
Reggie E. Cathy.
Is that his name? He plays her father, and clearly she's the adopted one. I don't have any problem with that. Who cares?
Yeah, I mean, that,
all I care about is, like, show me what is so compelling about your take on this, like, on this particular thing. And I don't see anything compelling there.
I agree.
Okay.
No, I really have nothing new to add to this, but I mean, I was never excited about this film being made in the first place, and I'm still, nothing's really changed my mind of interest. I like Michael B. Jordan, I like Miles Teller, but it's still, like, I have no interest in seeing this.
Yeah, I had no, Miles Teller left no impression on me until I saw Whiplash.
Okay.
Right, and I was like, okay, he's good. He's a very good actor. He's someone to watch out for. But having been, like okay, intrigued by Miles Teller, watching this thing, it doesn't do anything for me. You know, it doesn't really do anything for me. Okay, so his Reed Richards is nerdy, just like the last Reed Richards was, you know? It's weird to me. There's nothing that I see in a trailer that hooks me into it and says, okay, this approach is intriguing to me. I want to follow this project as it moves on, you know? Even like with the snippet, we got a Dr. Doom. It looks just like the Dr. Doom from the Tim Story movies.
I was reminded of like the White Queen in X-Men Origins Wolverine, like very dying looking.
Yeah. Well, anyway, before we move on, Jeff, how are you doing? Have you revisited any James Bond films? We were following your adventures in that way?
Unfortunately, no. I've seen everything but the James Bond movies.
Okay, cool. So then let's take a break to promote the other podcast content that's going on at This Is Infamous. And when we get back, we will talk about sort of an interesting topic. I guess what we call morally ambiguous filmmaking. I don't think that's even proper. Films that are, while technically fantastic achievements as films themselves, kind of leave an immoral, unethical, bad taste in one's mouth. Films like Birth of a Nation or, you know, Triumph of the Will. Even directors or personalities associated with the films. You know, where is that fine line? Can we still appreciate these films without having to deal with the baggage surrounding them? So as soon as we come back, we'll start to discuss that.
Hey, you got Toby Tom Clark here, pro wrestling analyst for thisisinfamous.com and host of The Main Event, the most infamous pro wrestling podcast in the universe. Each week I'll review WWE Raw with my co-host, wrestling journalist Steve Messa. Plus, we'll have all the big news from throughout the wrestling world and weekly guests from throughout the world of wrestling journalism. The Main Event, the most infamous pro wrestling podcast in the universe. And you can only get it on This Is Infamous Radio.
Be sure to listen to the Screenshots Movie Podcast at the beginning of every week here on the This Is Infamous Radio Network as Billy Donnelly and Brian McKevitt break down and discuss all the latest happenings in the movie world. Check it out at thisisinfamous.com as well as on iTunes and Stitcher.
Kablam!
Tired of the same boring interviews where the same questions are asked of the same people over and over and over again? Then it's time for real interviews. For real. This conversational podcast will bring you some insight into Hollywood's best and brightest. Real interviews. For real. It's not the same old stuff.
All right, we're back. Speaking of which, we just presented those three podcasts that are available through thisisinfamous.com. When you listen to our podcast, if you like what you hear, by all means, rate and comment on us on iTunes. You can access us through iTunes, which means you can download us, listen to us in your cars on your way to work or back, or whether you're traveling or things like that. A lot of you have already commented on us and rated us quite highly. We so appreciate that. Thank you so much. And the more the merrier. And having said that, let's continue on with our podcast. Today's topic's going to focus on films that, while have a place in film history as being considered great, technical achievements in filmmaking, display messages that are somewhat ethically or morally perverse, and whether or not we should separate the two, or can we separate the two? Can we still appreciate these films knowing, for example, that Birth of a Nation posits a reality where the KKK's save America, right?
Mm-hmm.
Should we overlook that absolutely obscene concept by acknowledging that it's still a great, well-made movie, or not? You know, so guys, you guys can start off the discussion. What are your thoughts on this?
Well, I'm on the fence a little with this. I guess it comes down to a case-by-case basis for me, whereas, like, Birth of a Nation, I can understand why it's considered a classic. You know, it advanced the technology and filmmaking, but at its heart, its message is just so fucked up, basically. But, you know, whereas I can clearly, say, okay, fuck this movie. Whereas then we come to somebody like Roman Polanski, who, you know, obviously, you know, has had his fair share of controversies and, you know, is really a convicted rapist.
Mm-hmm.
But yet he's made so many good films that it's like, some people write him off, others will still be like, even though, you know, that part of his personal life happened, but look at the films he did make, you know, and look at how good they are. And my thing is, that's why I'm in the middle. Like, I don't totally forgive Roman Polanski for the crimes he did, especially since he never really paid the cost for those crimes. And
to be fair, the whole case, legal case behind that is somewhat murky.
Yes, but
in terms of how that was approached and all that stuff. But go ahead.
But my thing is, I can't, like how you just watched Chinatown. There's, you know, other Roman Polanski films that are very, you know, beautiful and noteworthy. And I can't deny the beauty of those films, nor will I sit there and not watch any of his films based on, you know, what happened in his personal life. Because, unfortunately, I feel like if we judged every great work of art or anything that pushed us forward as a society on the person who discovered it, personal history, things might not have ever evolved. And
someone like Woody Allen?
Same thing there. He used to be one of my favorite filmmakers. But it's very hard, you know, with just seeing what happened in his life and the charges against him in his life. And it's like, it's sort of like, I guess, what music fans with Michael Jackson. You grew up loving him. Then all this evidence of him, you know, basically molesting children comes about.
Yeah, with Woody Allen, it's an interesting case because I still maintain Annie Hall's a great fucking movie.
Yes.
Right?
I think most Woody Allen films are great.
And I think Bananas is one of the funniest movies ever made. Manhattan, I thought was a great movie, but it's hard for me to revisit that now, knowing all this stuff that's come out on Woody Allen, mm-hmm. considering that that movie is about a middle-aged man having an affair with a very young girl.
Well, right? Luckily, it was never one of my favorite Woody Allen movies in the first place. But it also reminds me of, like, the Victor Salva case, you know, the director of Jeepers Creepers, where he actually went to prison for molesting a child. And then he comes out with this film, Powder, which is, like, basically almost a thinly veiled, not as graphic version of, you know, being accepted even though you're different. And it's, like, obviously kind of autobiographical. It's not a great film. But it's within those same lines.
It's weird. It's almost, but it's like Woody Allen's psychology seems to be different. It's like he seems to exist in his own, like, kind of like bubble where he sees.
And he doesn't see.
He seems absolutely like completely unaware that there's nothing wrong with his behavior.
Unfortunately,
he doesn't see
what
is wrong with what he's doing and why people would be critical of that.
Do you think go ahead.
No, go right ahead.
No, I was going to say, do you think he's always been this way, or do you think maybe it's the whole thing of celebrity at this point for him, where he's so used to having people, you know, be yes men more than really talking to him? Like, look, this is fucked up.
It might be a combination of both. I mean, this is a guy that still has creative autonomy with the films he makes. He makes like a film a year. They don't make a lot of money when they come out.
But yet he keeps getting to make them.
He keeps making them. And it's so obviously he exists in the bubble where he thinks that this is just the way things are. And will be forever, or something like that. And I don't know. I mean, I'm not a psychiatrist. I obviously don't know Woody Allen personally. But clearly,
Go ahead.
Go ahead.
No, it also doesn't help that he seems to be getting, like, the more charges against him, he seems to get more awards. I mean, I understand it's later in his life, so that
the difference between him and Roman Polanski, and I'm not excusing Roman Polanski at all. What he indulged in was statutory rape. And he knew that he was having sex with an underage girl. He knew that. And I don't care. I don't care how, you know, people like try to justify what happened thereby. You know, the court case was murky, you know, blah, 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 blah. There is a very good documentary out on that subject, by the way. But the fact is he committed statutory rape. But that's the only case we know of that. You know, it's one of those things where he can. And again, I'm not saying this to delegitimize what happened there. It's the only case we know of him doing that. You know, this happened shortly after the death of his wife, who died horrifically, had her fetus torn out of her stomach. You know, who knows what psychological state Polanski was in at that time. Again, not excusing what happened there, but Woody Allen seems to have this pattern of repeating history over and over again. You know, it's all out there, and he acts like, oh, there's nothing wrong with this. There's nothing wrong with this. This is normal, you know, kind of thing. And I'm finding, in his case, I'm finding it harder and harder to enjoy his movies because of that. You know, especially his most recent stuff, and then when it comes to, like, revisiting stuff like Manhattan, you know, things like that. Annie Hall still holds up. Those issues don't exist. They don't come up in an autobiographical way like they do in the other stuff. And I'm also kind of perturbed by this seemingly need on Woody Allen's part to kind of push this in our face and say, no, this is normal. What I'm doing is okay. That kind of bothers me a little bit.
Well, also with, you know, like, with most of his films, it's always an older male, younger female character falling in love, too.
Yeah.
And so,
you know, an older male who was never that good looking to begin with, but at least could somewhat survive on his charm and humor. You can't get away with that anymore at his age, and yet he's still trying to push this idea that's who he is, or through his characters. Not so with Polanski. You don't get, you know, when you watch his movies, it's not like every single movie Polanski makes is about a guy who has sex with an underage girl.
No. They're still pretty much the same types of films he was making before, more thrillers or dramas. And, you know, they might involve sex, but it's usually with, you know, characters the same age.
It involves mature characters dealing with mature characters.
Exactly.
Know? So
nothing self-referential as much.
Exactly. Andre, your thoughts?
I think you guys pretty much said everything there is to Woody Allen and Roman Polanski, but I wanted to bring up some other examples. Like, I look at somebody like, say, Mel Gibson, who, you know, there's all out and out evidence of the things that he said publicly about Jews and about black people, and, you know, the whole phone rant years ago, and it did hurt his career, but yet, even though it's hurt his career, he's still been able to get work. He is in the process of trying to get another movie directed, and for some reason, like, even when I look back,
well, he was a pariah for a while after that.
Yeah.
It seems like Hollywood goes to this phase where, like, if somebody's done something bad, they're a pariah for a while, And then the statutes of limitation wear off, whatever you want to call it, and they can go back to work again. You know, Alec Baldwin kind of goes through this phase in a much more limited way every now and then. But yeah, Mel Gibson was one of those guys where, like, okay, no one would touch him after all this. And they waited, and now he's slowly making his comeback, right?
Yeah, like, he still has all his buddies that he worked with as directors and actors, like Richard Donner and Danny Glover and company. But then you have somebody like, say, Bill Cosby. And, you know, there's no physical evidence of the things that he did, but there's enough accusers out there now where I can't watch The Cosby Show anymore. I can't watch his terrible ghost dad or any of the movies he did for Cartier anymore, because it's like, if I even look at the man, that's all I'm going to think of is the Spanish fly and, you know, having sex with women while they're asleep, you know?
The thing with Cosby also is that... Yeah, nothing's been proven, but almost everything was settled out of court.
Yeah.
Right?
And he's not, like, fighting to defend himself either. He's just staying silent the whole time.
Yeah, he's exactly. Like, oh, the evidence will, you know, I'll be cleared, you'll see. And it's like, nobody's going away. In fact, it seems like more cases are coming against him.
More cases are coming, and everybody is turning against him little by little. I mean, like, really respected celebrities are turning against this guy. We're saying nothing.
Well, even comedians who said they were inspired by him are now, like, denouncing him publicly.
Yeah, and that's too bad, because the thing with Cosby is that it's not like he has a career now. You know, he's not, like, appearing in any movies or TV shows. He's sort of, his career for the last 10 years has been sort of the elder statesman, you know, for comedians kind of thing.
Yeah, he's making his money. It's not like he really has to go out there and work
right.
more.
So it's not like whatever career he's had is affected by the bad news, you know?
No, it just tarnishes his history and all the breakthroughs he did make.
Whereas Mel Gibson, man, I mean, the whole Mel Gibson thing, you know, I as loath I am to say that I feel sorry for someone who's racist in his commentary, you know, clearly, the issue with Mel Gibson is severely mental issues there.
Yes. But the thing is, it seems like with Mel Gibson, even though he was a pariah and people were mad at him, he wasn't as denounced as the others people we've talked about. I mean, he couldn't find work, but it wasn't like anybody was like, I can't watch Lethal Weapon anymore.
Yeah, it wasn't like that at all.
Yeah, you know? Well, yes, and I don't know. I don't know if I agree with that. For one thing, I think what made up for that was we were oversaturated with images, audio recordings, you know, Joe Esterhaus wrote a whole article about his experience with his son hanging out at one of Mel Gibson's parties, you know, that got around. You know, we were, like, oversaturated with Mel Gibson is fucking nuts and not in a good way. Kind of stories that, you know, there was a time where, like, people were like, whoa, we got to step away from anything involving Mel Gibson, including watching his most beloved films. However, as bad as it got, there was no way in hell I was going to, like, never watch The Road Warrior again. Right.
Yeah. See,
I could live without Lethal Weapon.
Yeah. But
I could live without The Year of Living Dangerously. But I can't live without The Road Warrior.
Well, yeah, and for some people, they can't live without Braveheart.
Yeah.
Even though even at that time, it was controversial because supposedly, you know, that he was very, you know, anti-gay at the time.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So,
but what about specific movies? Like the ones I mentioned earlier, something like Birth of a Nation or Triumph of the Will.
Well, I said my piece on Birth of a Nation. Triumph of the Will, I will admit, I have not seen. But one of the reasons why I have not seen it might be since, you know, it's considered Nazi propaganda. And, you know, I don't really see myself wanting to sit through, you know, 90 minutes of that.
Right.
And, you know, especially, you know, something I don't believe in. I mean, of course, there's always the stories of how, you know, she was forced to do it if she wanted to keep working. And, you know, I wasn't there. I wasn't in the position to see what actually happened. But I will say, as probably a film lover, eventually I will see it, but I'm in no rush to see it.
Yeah, Leni Riefenstahl was a popular actress slash director. She was famous for starring in a genre of films that were popular at the time, mountaineering films. People living in villages and mountains, you know, kind of thing that was like big in Germany at the time. And she's been on record saying that she was more or less forced to make those things, but a lot of people cried bullshit on that.
Well, yeah, because I remember Jodie Foster even wanted to make a bio film about her, and that got turned into turnaround very fast. And...
I think it would be a very good bio film on her somewhere. Someone should do it, because there wouldn't be anything morally bad about that.
No.
That would be an awards and all kind of, like, portrayal. But Triumph of the Will is spectacular visually. It's absolutely spectacular. There's something about it that's also hypnotic, you know, it's in the way that says, like, you ever see Kai and Kwatsi, you know, that, like, the famous sort of documentary film that was released in theaters, like, you know, in the 90s? You know?
Yeah, I've seen it.
Right. It's kind of has that kind of feel to it in the way that it approaches its subjects. It's almost, like, visually poetic and all this stuff. But it's about Nazis. It's about praising Nazis, particularly the Aryan ideal. And it's really awkward and uncomfortable to watch, much in the same way that Birth of the Nation is. But Birth of the Nation, to me, is so laughably naive in its approach. to the point, like, really? I mean, I get that people were somewhat ignorant when it came to race relations, especially during the silent film era, as recently as the silent film era. But could you really be that stupid? Because it's a stupid movie. It's spectacular in its scope. It's considered one of the first feature-length movies ever made. And the scope is incredible. But it's so dumb. It's so stupid. So the elements that are, yes, they are racist, absolutely racist, but they're so ridiculous and so outlandish in its presentation. You cannot take it seriously. And to be honest, I'm kind of on the fence with this film as well. I understand why it's considered a landmark. It's unfortunate that this was the film that was the first feature-length film that had the kind of approach filmmaking in the way that it did. It was very innovative in a lot of, in terms of its camera work and narrative structure and all that stuff that no one had been doing up to that point before. I get that. I just wish it wasn't about what this film was about.
Well, it's also sort of like how the first sound picture, the jazz singer, you have Al Jolson in blackface.
Unfortunately, but you know what? This is the thing, though. The difference between like the jazz singer, which is a good film to bring up. I'm glad you did. The difference between the original jazz singer and something like Birth of the Nation. It's not like you had people that were racist. But a lot of people, that didn't mean that a lot of people were pro KKK.
Yeah.
Right.
I understand that.
Whereas in the jazz singer, it was, and I'm not saying that this made it okay by any means. It was a part of popular culture to do the blackface thing.
And more accepted at the time.
Right. you know, God, man, the 20s were really weird.
It was a part of history.
Yeah. It's just like if you watch the Shirley Temple films with, I forget who the actor, she's always dancing with the black actor.
Yeah, Andre, blackface was a part of our history, but the KKK saving America wasn't.
Well, of course, and it was a
racist based on the book.
Yeah, it's like this weird fantasy, like alternate reality take on American history. It's just where Abraham Lincoln is the bad guy, you know? It's just a really weird movie. And you just, it's like, I get there was naivete when it came to like social relations at that period of filmmaking, but not to that extent.
Yeah. I mean, like when I saw this film, it was in college and just watching, not even just watching the KKK as heroes, but like having white actors in blackface and the fake bushy hair. I mean, I wanted to throw up in my mouth in the classroom.
Whole scene when it's all, you know, African-Americans, ex-slaves, taking over Congress. That is just crazy.
And the attempted rape on the white woman. I mean, it was just...
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I literally wanted to like just throw shit onto the TV screen. That's how pissed off I was.
It's to the extent where you wonder, like Lillian Gish, who was like America's sweetheart. She was like the biggest female star at that time. What did she think about this? Like, did anybody speak up to this? You know, D.W. Griffin, what was he? D.W. Griffith, I'm sorry. What was he thinking? And did anyone try to stop him and say, dude, you know this is like nuts? You know?
It's like I was saying the other day, and I know it's a totally different culture here, but when I watched 7 Up, you know, that's how people who were white thought of black people at that time. They just thought we were all like just, you know, strange faced people with strange faced features. And, you know, that's what they were taught to realize, was that we were an inferior race to everybody else. So it wasn't so different back then either. It was a lot worse because that's the culture that people were raised in.
Well, we did have a long way to go. And this sort of ties into, we're talking about like race depiction in cinema. I mean, this ties into that like whole piece I wrote on James Bond, why can't James Bond be black, that kind of thing. How mm-hmm. like historically, like characters, minority characters were either presented as servants, slaves, or comic relief. But if we got like a great character that was a leader, a hero, usually that minority character was played by a white man in blackface. You know? And we're not just talking about African Americans, we're talking about Asians as well, Hispanics. Mm-hmm. You know, notoriously, Jewish actors were cast as Italians.
Yeah.
Italian actors mm-hmm. were cast as Native Americans. I mean, this is just the way it was. And you would have like British actors or Dutch actors were cast as like Mr. Moto, you know, or Charlie Chan, you know?
And John Wayne as Genghis Khan.
John Wayne as Genghis Khan, exactly, exactly. Which is deservedly, not considered a good film. It's a terrible film.
Yeah, but then you have like Breakfast at Tiffany's, which is considered a classic, and you have right. Mickey Rooney doing his, I guess, impression of an Asian man.
Which is painful.
Yes.
It's painful to watch. And it kills me because that's a Blake Edwards film and I fucking love Blake Edwards. You know? I just, God. The things that apparently we thought was funny, are not funny.
Well, even if you go, for a more modern take, look at all the, like at the time it was funny, but now a lot of people take a particular insult when it comes to Long Duck Dong and 16 Candles.
Oh, yes.
Characterization.
Yeah.
And
you know what? Yeah.
That started a whole discussion with John Hughes being racist, which he isn't, but the way he depicts minorities in his films, they're always like the black guys in Weird Science and the nightclub. And yes.
Oh, don't forget in National Lampoon's Vacation when they go to the black neighborhood.
And then there was also the black guy that steals Cameron's car on Ferris Bueller's Day Off. Like, this guy has a tendency, because he's in this middle America mindset, that he has to take minorities and make them into stereotypes, because that's all he knows. He doesn't know how to write about
it. Yeah, he is from, like, the Midwest. So.
Yeah.
And my thing that's really...
That's a very good point.
Put black people in The Breakfast Club. It'd be a totally different film.
Well, see, here's the thing that, with Ferris Bueller, I find even more interesting, is that he portrays the guy... One guy is Hispanic, one guy as black who steal the car, when actually Richard Edson is white.
Yeah, you know, and sometimes what doesn't help is that certain minorities, when they have the opportunity to tell their story, they sometimes perpetuate the stereotype.
Are we talking Soul Plane?
Or, you know, movies that are about gangsters, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah, was another one I was going to mention.
Which doesn't help at all. And you don't know how much of that is, well, we're making these films because I couldn't make a film if I didn't make a film this way, right?
Yeah.
But, you know, a film I saw Tribeca, which I can talk about because the embargo's lifted, it's called Cronies.
The movie I want to see.
Right, produced by Spike Lee. If you watch this film, it feels like an early Spike Lee film. This could ostensibly been a minority take on something like The Hangover. The whole film takes place in the course of one night. It deals with three friends. But the perspective is from this lower income minority perspective. Now, that in itself could have been problematic because one of the character, you know, you have these two characters who kind of grew up in the ghetto and kind of flirted with crime and all that stuff. One of whom is probably more involved in it than the other. The other character is now trying to make like a really honest life out of himself because now he has a kid. And he's got, like, a real job, and he's met a friend through that job that he wants to hang out with at that night, whereas the other friend is jealous of this. And so he forced himself upon whatever it is they're going to do that night. Now, when you watch this film, I'm not going to give any away, it's very funny, it's very quirky, but you see, like, little clues that this film is going to go in the direction where all this guy, you know, someone's going to wind up dead, yep. Right? It's going to involve crime. Someone has a gun. This is not going to work out too well. Which is something we've seen in a lot of films that kind of like deal with this kind of scenario, right? Well, I'm happy to say the film doesn't go in a direction that you think it goes, right? It actually goes in a very positive direction, which was refreshing. But there's a lot of filmmakers who try to tell this similar kind of story where they're only perpetuating that kind of sort of like idea that, you know, everybody wants to be a gangsta. You know, everyone wants to, like, live fast and die young kind of thing, you know, without what? Yeah, go ahead.
Well, sometimes I also, because I brought this up when we did, when we had our black cinema show, I think sometimes it's also what the market is willing to pay for. Because, okay, I found it interesting, for instance, this year when everybody was complaining about how supposedly the Oscars were racist, but it was like, every black film out there that wasn't, let's say, your traditional film, you had Dear White People, you had Selma, you had Beyond the Lights. But it was like, yeah, you want you complain that there's no quality films, but it's not like, you know, everybody is going out to see these films either.
Yeah, and Cronies is the kind of film that can bridge that gap because it's interesting. I'm not spoiling anything, but it's like when they come across a person who is successful because he's a drug dealer. He's like a normal white guy, hipster type, who is also a stockbroker, which is the way it is now, you know, that kind of thing. And it's interesting how they kind of set up this whole thing where they're going to compare like sort of the myth of the stereotypes versus what the reality is and whether or not things are as badass as people would like to make them out to be. You know, that people are more complex than that, you know, that kind of thing. And I highly recommend Cronies, by the way. It's a very good movie if ever it gets released. I enjoyed it very much. Any thoughts beyond the depiction of race? I mean, we're getting back to the subject in hand. Are you know, you mentioned like John Hughes films.
Mm-hmm.
You'd be very hard pressed to find someone that would refuse to watch 16 Candles because of the depiction of an Asian American character, right?
Exactly. Well, maybe only other Asian Americans might refuse to watch it because they've heard about the depiction. Or either that, or it'll be like how Andre was saying, watching Birds of a Nation is something where you're going to be very angry watching this film. And like, this is what, you know, everybody raved about. And
well, also though, but why does something like 16 Candles get a pass, but not something like Birth of a Nation?
I think, well, as you said before, Birth of a Nation has, first of all, this ridiculous premise in the first place that, you know, the Klan is going to save America. Whereas 16 Candles, what is supposed to be just a comedic tale about a girl who's, I guess, finding her first love and, you know, her family forgets. Instead, you throw in this whole Asian stereotypish character. You know, and he's obviously the big comedic relief of the film. And they even give him a ridiculous, demeaning name, Long Duck Dong.
But like, could you make the argument that there's something more dangerous and more ethically negative about something that's presented in, I'm not saying it's subtle, I'm saying in that
more of a subliminal message.
Yeah, within a more subtle, you know, a subtler context than something like Birth of a Nation, which is so out there, so clearly racist, you can't take it seriously.
Well, I think it depends on also – I think it also depends on your – like how we were talking about John Hughes coming from the Midwest. He might not have, you know, as much, you know, culture around him when it came to other races, especially when he was growing up in the 50s and 60s. Whereas it also depends on the viewer watching this film, if they've ever had an exposure to Asian Americans as people, you know, just as friends or having a conversation with, you obviously realize this is ridiculous, this is over the top and insulting. But if it's somebody who's watching this as a kid, young and doesn't know any better, they might think this is true as well as being hilarious.
Yeah.
Same thing, even like, it's not racist, but take data from the Goonies. Some people could find that as insulting. And
true. Or what's his name from the Hangover movies?
Ken
Jeong.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I could see that.
You know, or take
although data. I'm loath to say this, they do offer his character more complex shades.
Well, later
than
on.
Than we've seen in like bad racist stereotypes, you know?
But I guess it's the same thing that, like, with Italian-Americans complain about when they're always mobsters. But it's not as bad for them as it is for other minorities because most people will give, like, let's say, they don't think every Italian is a gangster necessarily.
Right.
But there's also the point you can make, too, that they could complain that they're getting typecast as gangsters, but yet how many people actually embrace a movie like Goodfellas? Go to any pizza parlor in New York City, you're going to be seeing Goodfellas posters.
Yeah, they're proud of the depiction.
Yeah, it's a weird, complex thing. I think we go through like stages too of like what subsets are badly misrepresented. But not only that, sometimes there's a weird thing going on where people within that community, whether they know it or not, help to perpetuate that stereotype. I mean, I had a lot of Italian-American friends. I was married into an Italian-American family where, you know, people are like, oh, I refuse to watch Goodfellas or any Scorsese film. It makes us look bad as Italians. And yet they would talk about great, the mafia has a good, you know, does do a service to the Italian communities in some places in ways that the police can't, you know, stuff like that. You know, and it's just like weird kind of thing, you know. That so some of it is some of those stereotypes are perpetuated within the communities that want to negate it, so to speak.
Right. Well, that's why I bring up a movie like, say, Superfly, for example, where yes, you have like this tough black character who defies the man and wins, but at the same time, when you really look back, there's nothing like really sympathetic about him because he's a drug dealer and. Yeah, he's trying to get out of the business, but at the expense of poisoning his community to get out of it.
Well, yeah, like the Mac. What about the Mac?
Yeah, no, yes. Same deal.
That's always been my problem with these films, whereas I want to stand behind these characters, but you can't help but notice, you know, their success is our peril, almost. And,
right.
And so, you know.
And then the kids start to look up to them, which is what happened with Scarface. And I'm talking about the remake specifically, where right. All of a sudden, everybody in the urban community wants to become Tony Montana, even though he kills his best friend and basically fucks up his whole life with cocaine and ultimately ends his life and his sister's. But yet, because of his struggle to get to where he got to, it's like he's a folk hero to everybody. And I know for Brian De Palma, that still disturbs him.
Well, I mean, this actually ties into something we haven't gotten into. I mean, we talk about the obvious, like films about where the KKK are your hero, you know, or, you know, where it's all about being pro-Aryan, pro-Nazi, you know, the obvious, or films directed by guys who have committed heinous crimes, right? Mm-hmm. Things like that, or the depiction of race and whether or not we should encourage that. But now we're getting into this like fine line thing now, like, okay, so where do you draw the line on this? In other words, should you enjoy something like Hannibal, the Hannibal Lecter movies, when your lead protagonist, your hero, is arguably a cannibalistic killer?
Well, see, that's where it starts getting weird, because then It's sort of like the Freddy movies where everybody, he became sort of a pop culture, like, icon hero. But you're forgetting, this is a guy who killed children.
And he was a pedophile.
Exactly.
I mean, what is the answer? Do we go back to, like, the whole Hays Code thing where crime doesn't pay, can never pay in film?
I think it's all up to the individual, really, because you can't really ban these films.
Right.
But I
mean,
guess,
should we think that something like Dirty Harry is morally reprehensible because the cop breaks the law by taking the law in his own hands? You know.
Well, even with the Death Wish movies, the same deal with just
right.
You know, this idea that vigilantism is a good thing for the community.
Fuck the Batman films.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When it comes down to it, you know. So, like, yeah, where do we draw the line on this? And I don't know. I just think it makes for a very interesting topic of conversation. Which
but
this
I will
has
say the
been.
Batman films, the Nolan ones, really hit home this idea that, yeah, you could have this hero who is trying to wipe clean out of Gotham, but once you get to Dark Knight, it's like he's only making the problem worse.
So are you saying that's the filmmaker's responsibility to show both aspects of this? Not just one aspect?
I think they should explore more than one aspect, maybe, when it comes to something like that. Nice. That's what makes it more interesting.
Yes. And,
okay. Mm. All right. Well, I think I don't have anything more to say on the subject. Plus, you know, we're kind of like run over time at this point. But this is a great conversation. I thought it was fascinating. And I hope it was fascinating for you too, our listeners. So
please
much so
tell us.
That you'll rate and comment on us on YouTube or YouTube, iTunes. And having said that, yes, please follow us on Facebook. We have a Facebook group. Join it. Have a similar cinephile style discussions. We usually join in on those discussions as well. Like us on Facebook. We have a separate Facebook page. That way you can get automatic updates when the latest podcast video episodes are up. Whether or not we've written articles for either This Is Infamous or for CinephilesTV.blogspot.com, which Jeff is keeping alive. And believe it or not, we are still doing the TV or the TV internet TV version of our show. I just have not gotten to be able to edit any of them yet because I've been so damn busy. But yeah, we got at least 3 episodes ready to be edited there, so there's plenty of content. And by the time I'm done with that, we're going to have shot more content, which is also good news. And of course, like us all individually on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, check out our Google Plus circles, all that stuff. And with that, I'm Eric Cohen, co-producer, co-host of CineFiles. Andre Joseph, co-host of the CineFiles.
Good night and good luck.
Jeff Galishaw, co-host of the CineFiles, producer and primary host of Unfinished Business.
See you next week.
I sincerely hope that you don't find our series morally reprehensible. With that, I bid you adieu.
This is Infamous Radio. It's now off the air.
The CineFiles podcast is a part of This Is Infamous Radio and This Is Infamous Media. Executive produced by Billy Donnelly and Eric Cohen. 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 Cohen.